Thank you. Dearly beloved in the Lord Jesus Christ, we have gathered together on this beautiful day for a beautiful occasion. We've come together to join together Eric and Nagabush in holy matrimony. You ready, Nagabush? All right. In this wedding ceremony, we seek to honor the will of God for marriage, the Christian church for its well-being, and to see how the picture of the wedding of Eric and Nagabush, that's the last time, I promise, Eric and Natalie, can be a picture of the gospel of Jesus Christ. You can be seated. Let's pray together. God, our Father, we praise you for creating us good and making us in your image. We exalt you for the redemption that we've come to know in Christ Jesus. And we thank you for the love and trust which bring Eric and Natalie to this, their wedding day. Favor them with the honor of your presence at this ceremony, we pray. Unite them by your Spirit so that together they may reflect the love of Christ for his church. It's through Jesus Christ our Lord that we pray. Amen. Who gives this woman to this man? Well, you both have made it through the hardest part of the wedding ceremony. Natalie, you've made it up to the platform in a long dress, which is very difficult. So that's really good. And Eric, I mean, I know my dad, so I was like 95% sure he was going to say yes for you having Natalie. But like, there was that 5% that I thought he was going to be like, you know what? This is too much for me right now. So I feel like the hardest part of the wedding you are both through. So congratulations. We get a chance now to hear the meaning of marriage is ordained by God. In marriage is instituted by God, a man and a woman covenant to live together in a lifelong and an exclusive partnership of love and fidelity. If marriage is to be pleasing in the sight of God, those who enter into this covenant of life must share a common commitment to the Lord of life. And I know that you both have that common commitment to the Lord of life. I'm really thankful for that. In putting his blessing on marriage, God intended that it would provide a context within which husband and wife can help and comfort each other and find companionship, a setting within which husband and wife may give loving and tender expression to the desires that God has given to us. I'll explain that later to you guys. A secure environment within which children may be born and taught to know and serve the Lord, and a structure that enriches our communities. Now, when these purposes are prayerfully pursued in union with Christ, the kingdom of God is advanced and the blessedness of the husband and the wife is assured. And more than that, the Apostle Paul sees the union of husband and wife as a symbol of the union between Christ and the church. And Paul gives this instruction: wives, submit to your husbands as to the Lord, and husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. This is a profound mystery, says Paul, and I'm saying it refers to Christ and the church. Let each one of you love his wife as himself, and let the wife see that she respects her husband. Now, we have a sinful and a selfish tendency to tear down what God has built. And that threatens marriage with tensions and with agony and even sometimes with broken bonds. But those that marry in the Lord, as you are doing right now, you can be assured of the fact that the Lord will graciously lead and provide for you as you follow the biblical pattern for love, which is love is patient, love is kind. It doesn't envy. It doesn't boast. It's not proud. It's not rude. It's not self-seeking. It's not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but it rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, and always perseveres. Love never fails. Now, Eric and Natalie, now that you've heard God's message concerning marriage, do you agree with it, and do you commit yourselves to the other in accordance with it? Eric, what's your answer?
I do.
And Natalie, what's your answer?
I do.
Praise the Lord. Well, the grandfather of the bride is now going to come up and offer a prayer. I think it's on, yeah.
Please bow with me in prayer. O Lord, our Lord, how great is your name in all the earth. We thank you for these precious moments that we can witness. We thank you that you have brought together two of your precious children to declare their love and loyalty for life before us. And our Lord, we pray as we hear their vows to each other, we may recommit our vows to others, and especially to you, our gracious God, in whose name we pray. Amen.
Amen. We're going to sing together now the song, Speak, O Lord. The words are written in the wedding program that you received when you came in. And so will you please stand as we sing together, Speak, O Lord. I have a message now that comes to you from Ephesians chapter 5. And the bride and the groom chose this section of scripture, and I'm excited that I get a chance to read it, and I'm excited that I get to give a brief message on it. Just before I read, I want to say this is a different sort of experience for me, because I've done a number of weddings, but you know, there are basically four women in the world that I love more than any other, and one is my wife, one's my mom, and the other two are my sisters. And so it's kind of an emotional thing to stand up here along with my sister. You're getting the best, man. Well, tied for best, I guess, with like slightly under my best, maybe, I think. Like, you know what I'm saying. You're getting the best. Ephesians chapter 5, verses 19 to 33. I'm actually going to begin at the very end of Ephesians chapter 5, verse 18. We're told, be filled with the Holy Spirit, addressing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody to the Lord with your heart, giving thanks always and for everything to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, submitting to one another out of reverence for Christ. Wives, submit to your own husbands as to the Lord, for the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, his body, and is himself its Savior. Now as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit in everything to their husbands. Husbands, love your wives, as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her, that he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of water with the word, so that he might present the church to himself in splendor, without spot or wrinkle or any such thing, that she might be holy and without blemish. In the same way, husbands should love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself, for no one has ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes it and cherishes it, just as Christ does the church, because we are members of his body. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and mother and hold fast to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. This mystery is profound, and I'm saying that it refers to Christ and the church. However, let each one of you love his wife as himself, and let the wife see that she respects her husband. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, as we consider these words inspired by your Holy Spirit, we pray, along with the song that we've just sung, that you would speak. We pray that you would speak, Lord, and that you would take these truths and that you would implant them into each of our hearts. And we pray especially for Eric and for Natalie, that you would use these words to strengthen them as they begin the life that they will share together. All of this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, these are some challenging and deep words that the Apostle Paul gives to us. And they're challenging because they might, frankly, strike us the wrong way. But they're deep because they tell us that the great mystery of marriage points to the beauty of the gospel itself and the drama of redemption that we've come to know in Christ Jesus. And in marriage, both husband and wife are called to picture Jesus Christ. Both husband and wife are called to picture our Savior and Lord Jesus. Natalie, you're called to image and picture Jesus as he submits to the Father and comes to earth for us and for our salvation. And Eric, you're called to picture Jesus as he lays down his life for the sake of his bride, the church. And Eric, just man to man, this is like really hard. like very hard. This is dangerous and it's alive. Headship is not something that was safe for Jesus Christ. It's not something that was ever comfortable for him. It was not, and it is not, and it will never be something that the members of Christ's body would ever choose for themselves. But to be a man as Christ was a man is to embrace that danger, not with bravado, but in deep humility. And so these deep commands that are given to us, inspired by the Holy Spirit, are possible when we look to Jesus, when we are redeemed by him, and when we become a part of that incredible drama of redemption. Because the reality of the story of the Bible is not only that it's inspired by God, but it is, in fact, the greatest story that has ever been told. It's the greatest drama that there ever has been. I mean, think about the story that you are able to participate in as husband and wife. In that story, God, who exists as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit eternally, with no deficiency, in perfect love, determines that because of an overflow of that love, he will create the world. And he created it good. And at the climax of his creation, the crowning jewel of his creation, he made a man and a woman, created in his image. And that was very good. But the story takes a dark turn because a nemesis shows up and deceives the man and the woman, and they fall into sin. And this is a sin that we all know too well. It's a sin that we're all born into, a sin that leads to broken relationships with each other and broken relationships with God. And the good creation of God and the crowning jewel of the Lord's creation, the man and the woman, humanity itself, are marred now by sin. But despite the marring of that sin, God still sees the beauty of those he has created, and he purposed to save out of that sin, out of that muck, out of that filth. Despite the marring of the beauty that we all experience, your Creator took delight in you and determined to save you. And so Christ came in intelligent and self-giving and equal submission to the Father that the bride gets to picture. And he came into this beautiful and sin-sick world to seek and to save the lost, to save those who are marred by sin, to save those that experience the effects of the fallen world, the original sin into which we are all born, to save those that have experienced the negative effects of our own sin. And Christ, having come to seek and to save the lost, was perfect in every possible way. He was faithful in every way that his people have been faithless. And Christ, at the end of his life, went to the cross to bear the just wrath of the Father because of sin. And he did this because he loved his bride. He loved his chosen people. He loved the royal priesthood and the holy nation that is his church. And as he was nailed to the cross, he was the God-man, and so he was able to see all of that sin and all of the filth and all of the muck into which we were all born, that which characterizes each of us. He was able to see through history and to see the sins of all of those that he was dying to save. And as he saw you and me, and he saw the filthiness and the sin, he stayed. And he died. And that's the self-giving love that needs to characterize your relationship with your bride, with my sister. And this is the point of the message where the pastor typically gives advice about how this can be lived out. And sometimes a pastor at a wedding ceremony can give you advice that seems a little trivial and everyday, like, groom, if you want to show her that you love her, you got to let her win sometimes in games that you're playing. I got to tell you, Eric, that's not my advice to you, because you'll never be able to beat my sister in anything. You will never be able to let her win, because she's always going to beat you fair and square. If it's okay, it is true, Natalie. I'm going to illustrate it with a story from our childhood, if that's okay. This is one story. Just allow me one story. Natalie is in middle school, right? And it turns out she's an exceptional soccer player. And me and my brother Evan over there and Natalie decide that we're going to play soccer together. And Natalie is always the sort of person that if there's any unfairness, she makes sure it's visited on herself so that nobody else has to experience that sort of thing, right? And so as we were deciding how we were going to divide up teams, she's like, well, why don't we play girls versus boys? And of course, it's me and Evan against Natalie, right? And she's in like sixth or seventh grade. I'm in high school at this point, right? So I'm like, this is great. This is going to be a fantastic game of soccer. And I mean, Evan's passes weren't as crisp as they needed to be that day. But nonetheless, she destroyed us. She destroyed us because she was that much better at us at soccer. And so I'm sorry about this, Eric. I've got to tell you the truth. Your wife is more athletic than you are, and probably smarter than you are, and more attractive than you are. And so, I mean, that's not to say you're none of those things. It's just, I mean, you know? So I don't have any of that trivial sort of advice that pastors can sometimes give to brides and to grooms on their wedding day. But what I have for you is more general, but some deeper advice. And that is, die to yourself and live for Christ. And this is to both of you. Die to yourself and live for Christ. Die to yourself and let the Spirit live in you. That's the way that this passage begins. Be filled with the Spirit. You know, participating in this incredible drama, the drama that husband and wife are able to live out, is possible when you are filled with the Spirit, so that you can die to yourself and live for the other. And so die to yourself and be filled with the Spirit. And maybe there is one other practical tip that I can give you, and that's sing. This is what verses 19 and 20 say. Address one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. Sing and make music in your hearts to the Lord, giving thanks always for everything to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Do you want to multiply your joy? Then sing to each other. I know that sometimes you've been forced to do that with family, and it can be daunting at times, I understand. But sometimes there's nothing that can express the joy that's inside of us like singing. And there are incredible songs to be able to do that. And so now and again, when you're with each other, sing. Make music in your heart to the Lord. Give thanks to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. And so sing together. And make sure that this self-sacrificing, self-giving, self-dying love and thankfulness permeates the life that you live together to the glory of God the Father. Amen. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for bringing together Eric and Natalie. We thank you for the incredible drama into which they are now entering. We praise you for the fact that they are able to participate in marriage in the incredible story of the redemption of the gospel of Jesus Christ. We pray that they would take up that challenging task with joy and that you would fill them with your Spirit so that they might die to themselves and live for the other. All of this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, the bride and the groom are now going to be honoring their grandparents during the singing of the song, Great is Thy Faithfulness. And one remarkable evidence of the faithfulness and the provision of God is that all eight grandparents are still living. I think that that's beautiful and remarkable, so we're thankful for that. And so the first verse of Great is Thy Faithfulness is going to be sung by a beautiful soloist. Hey. And so that beautiful soloist is going to sing verse 1 and the first chorus of Great is Thy Faithfulness. At that point, Eric and Natalie are going to be honoring their grandparents. And once the second verse begins, I'm going to invite everyone to stand and we'll join together and sing verses 2 and 3 and the second and the third chorus together.
Oh, 3:12-17. Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with one another and forgive one another if any of you has a grievance against someone. Forgive as the Lord forgave you. And over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body, you were called to peace. And be thankful. Let the message of Christ dwell among you richly, as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom, through psalms, hymns, and songs from the Spirit, singing to God with gratitude in your hearts. And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him.
Amen. Thank you so much, Kelly. Well, Eric and Natalie, marriage is a covenant. It's an oath-bound commitment ceremony, and that commitment must not be broken. And the central act of that ceremony are the vows that you get to make to each other right now. And so, Eric, would you please repeat after me? I, Eric, take you, Natalie,
I, Eric, take you, Natalie,
to be my wife,
to have and to hold,
from this day forward,
for better, for worse,
for richer, for poorer, in sickness and health, to love and to cherish, till death do us part. Natalie, would you repeat after me? I, Natalie, take you, Eric.
I, Natalie, take you, Eric.
To be my husband.
To be my husband.
To have and to hold.
To have and to hold.
From this day forward.
From this day forward.
For better and for worse.
For better and for worse.
For richer, for poorer.
For richer, for poorer.
In sickness and health.
In sickness and health.
To love and to cherish.
To love and to cherish.
Till death do us part. Now the exchange of rings. Eric, would you repeat after me? Natalie, I give you this ring,
Natalie, I give you this ring,
as a symbol of our covenant in Christ.
Symbol of our covenant in Christ.
And Natalie, will you also repeat after me? Eric, I give you this ring,
Eric, I give you this ring,
as a symbol of our covenant in Christ. Eric and Natalie are committing themselves to humble service of the other throughout their married life together. And so as a part of the marriage ceremony, they are going to be following their Lord's example and washing the other's feet.
King of love, my shepherd is, whose goodness faileth never. I'm nothing lack if I am his, and he is mine forever, and he is mine forever. Water flow, my ransomed soul he leadeth, and where the verdant pastures grow, with fruit celestial feeding, never failing, ruler of my heart, everlasting, lover of my soul. Lost and foolish, I'll fast stray. dead in love, he saw me, and on his shoulder gently lay, and home rejoicing brought me. In death's dark veil, I fear no ill, with thee, dear Lord, beside me. Thy rod and staff, my comfort still, the cross before to guide me. Never failing, ruler of my heart, everlasting, lover of my soul.
Pray together. Father in heaven, we pray that you would give today your blessing upon the marriage of Eric and Natalie. We thank you for the vows that they've spoken and the love in which they are now united. Keep them faithful and strong in every trial. Sustain their joy and affection for many years. We pray, Lord Jesus, that you will be acknowledged the head of their homes and the rest for their souls and the master of their lives. Equip them, Holy Spirit, with patient endurance and sacrificial service and unfailing courtesy and endless trust and lasting love, and grant that their home will often be a place of laughter and peace, and in times of difficulty or trouble, that it might be a haven of healing and forgiveness. May they give constant praise to you, Eternal Father, who with the Son and the Spirit is God, blessed and exalted forever. Amen. As a minister of the Church of Jesus Christ, and by the authority that the state has vested in me, I now pronounce you Eric and Natalie, husband and wife. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Therefore, what God has joined together, let no one put asunder. Eric, you can kiss your bride, but remember, that's my sister. That was so tasteful. It's very acceptable. It's my great pleasure to introduce for the very first time Mr. and Mrs. Eric and Natalie Jensema.